people always ask me, when did you first call somebody an Iron Man? Because it's not like all of a sudden I picked up a microphone and, hey, you're an Iron Man, I'm calling a 5K. They go, what the hell is that? Because I was in 19 races back in San Diego and Southern California from the late 70s through the 80s, and I wasn't invited to come to Kona until 89. And that was the year, by the way, I was going to do the race. So I've been on the microphone ever since. So don't ask me if I've ever done an Ironman, because I've been on the microphone ever since. But what happened in 89 and 90, I never said that. Didn't even think about it. The other announcers I was working with, nobody ever said, you're an Ironman. Because it just never, you know, I'd say, congratulations, you're unbelievable, way to go, great day. Whatever we can do to accentuate that person's life right there at that finish line. When you combine their act with audio, there's something powerful about that if you're saying the right words to people. So in 1991, I'm walking down the street in Kona. It was my third year there, down at Leahy Drive, and I see a buddy who was a runner and a triathlete in San Diego that I knew. I go, hey, how you doing? Hey, good, you know, I'm all right. What's wrong? I don't know. I don't know if I can get this done. I go, what do you, the guy's a stud. So I go, what do you, I've run with you, I've trained, you're gonna do it. What, are you kidding me? I couldn't understand where it was coming from, because he didn't tell me. I found out later where it was coming from, but he was all nervous. And I said, don't worry, you're gonna be an Iron Man. He goes, yeah, Riley. I go, you'd be okay. And it just really dumbfounded me, because I knew the guy was a stud, and I'm going, I don't get it, what's wrong? Well, to tell you the end of the story, the year before, he had a terrible, terrible day, missed his time by like 3 hours, so he went to redeem himself. That's why he was so nervous. So race day came. I don't remember him going into the water. I don't remember bringing him out of the water. I don't remember seeing him at the hot corner, you know, because the day's going on. And, you know, some people I'll meet the day before the race, and I see him 7 times. I go, oh my, hey, man, hey, man, hey. My best friend's doing the race. Riley, you didn't even look at me. So race day comes, and I didn't see him go in the water or see him at the hot corner, and didn't really know what kind of time he was going to do. But it was just after 11 hours. He went like 11:30 something. Here he comes down to Leahy Drive. I see him. I spot him. Back then, we didn't have what they call the read mats, say 80 yards up from the finish, where the name would pop up on a computer as it does now, and I retype it into another thing. You know, we got a whole process. So we're like this, you know, 486, 486, 486, or reading it off a sheet of paper. So anyway, I see him coming. I recognize him. The other announcer, I go, I want this guy. So I start saying his name, where he's from, and I recalled our conversation, and it just came out. I go, you are an Iron Man. And he goes like this, and he looks, and he points to me, and something just felt so right and good when I said it. And then the crowd uproared, louder than like for the winners, I go. So I'm like no dummy, you know. You react off crowds, and you see how people are reacting to what you're saying. That's all we have. We're live, so any mistake you made, everybody knows about it. Anything good you make, they react to it. And I go, wow, and he comes in, and it was cool. The next person that was being called was by the other announcer that was there. He didn't say it. And I go, why don't you call him an Iron Man? The crowd loves it, and the athletes, I think they'll like it. He goes, no, I don't want to do that. So I'm thinking, the hell with you. The next one comes in. So this woman's coming in. And I go, all right, Iron Man, Iron Woman. It's an Iron Man race. Yeah, what the heck? You are an Iron Man. And she's just like this in the crowd. Well, as the day went on, the other announcer would announce, and he wouldn't say it, and I'd hear boos. So I'm going, so I finally got aggressive, and I started calling like one after another. And remember, that year we only had probably, 1,300 a race, so I had gaps, you know, like one at a time. So they were coming, and I'd go, you're an Iron Man. And then he'd get on, and the crowd would say, say you are an Iron Man! So somebody interviewed me about 5 months ago, And in the interview, after I told the story to them, they said, "Who is that guy?" I'm embarrassed to say, I remember he had a three-letter first name. I forgot him. I hadn't been in contact with him. I forgot his name. I don't even remember. So I had to, afterwards I go, I gotta find him. Because I am writing a book right now, and there's research wanted. I have to find him. Long story short, I called Scott Tinley, because I knew the guy was a firefighter or a lifeguard in San Diego. And I used to run with him. "Oh, Tinley, I'm good. In 91, I was on, man." He goes, "No." I said, "Was it Jimmy Black?" He goes, "No, it wasn't Jimmy Black." "Well, it could be. Call him up." I called Jimmy. I hadn't talked to Jimmy in 18 years, 20 years. "Riley, how the hell are you? What are you doing?" "I'm retired." You know, he's telling me. And I go, "Hey, were you in Kona in 91? "Yeah." I think, "Oh, my God. I found, you know, my guy, Jimmy Black. Jimmy." And I go, "Jimmy, in 91, did we have a conversation on the street?" "Yeah, we talked all week long." "Oh, great." I go, "Well, when you did the race," he goes, "Oh, I didn't do the race." "What are you talking about? Who goes to Kona and doesn't do the race back then, you know?" He goes, "No, I, you know, Timothy's a buddy of mine. I just wanted to give him a hard time out on the race course, so I was drinking the whole time, just having fun." So I go, I told him the story, and he goes, "Well, talk to Jay Larson." And Jay's an old running buddy from back in the day in San Diego. I go, "You got his number?" "Yeah." I call him up. Jay goes, "Riley, how the hell are you?" We have this huge conversation. He goes, "No, but do you have the list?" And I have the database. I go, "I've looked through it. The name doesn't..." He goes, "Let me look through it." The next day he called me up. He goes, "I got a guy for you, Dan Trone, T-R-O-N-E. I go, "Damn, Dan Trone. That's just, okay. Well, why do you say that?" "Well, because he did the race 1 year, didn't do well, came back and did it the next, da-da-da. Maybe try him." He goes, "He's a friend of mine on Facebook. I'll Facebook and let him know that you're going to call." I call, maybe like a day later. "Right, is it you?" "Yeah, Dan. How are you?" "Hey, remember all those runs on Mission Bay?" "Well, I don't remember none." We did so much running with so many guys, you know, women back then. I didn't know. So anyway, I go, "Danny, did we have a conversation on the street in Kona?" He goes, "Yeah, we did." I was so nervous because I did, he said, S-H-I-T, the bed, the year before. I had a terrible day, and I wanted to come back and have a good day. And I go, "So I called you an Ironman." He goes, "Yeah." And he said it in kind of an aggressive way. I go, "Yeah, I did." He goes, "Yeah." And I thought I was going to be the only one you were going to see. On the phone, I'm dropping, I'm writing notes. The only one, say it to me. And I go, "Really?" He goes, "Yeah." And then I'm behind the finish line and you say it to another guy. I thought that was between you and me. So I guess, and you've done it quite a bit since, you know? Because how many times? I go, "I've been afraid, I'm like 350,000 times." But I was the first. He goes, "If you want to put me in the book, put me in the book." So that's the story of finding the first guy that had ever done an Ironman.